Good morning. So today I would like to talk about an ideal workspace where it should be clean, neat, and stress-free. I'm going to show you a bad workplace. And this is a very cluttered, messy table. So I just threw everything on the table, and if this looks familiar, then it's a good idea to clean your table before you start your practice. The reason is because if we were to work in this environment, it might seem okay, you can still write, but your arm is kind of confined to such a little space. And let's say if you want to do a big oval, like you want to do a flourish like that. I already find it very cramped because my hand is knocking against bottles and books and things, and it would not allow for a free flowing oval. And it's very important to have a clear space for the arm to move, especially for doing big ovals, because even a little knock would disturb the flow. This is pretty bad. Another reason is because there are open bottles of ink, and there's dirty water and tea, things like that. It may cause you to maybe knock over a bottle and ruin your desk. And also the ink is black, which is not good as well because it might damage your nibs if the water is too dirty. And if you have electronic devices, knocking over water or whatever would add to the stress. And there's always a possibility that you might accidentally dip into your tea instead of the water. So now I'm just going to clean up my table and show you what it should look like in an ideal study environment. Okay, so I have cleaned up my desk and it just takes a couple of minutes, but you can see what a difference it makes. It looks inspiring and fresh and clean and neat, and it just makes you want to sit down and write all day. So, most importantly, the space here is clear, so I'm free to move my arm wherever I want. And all the bottles of ink are closed except the actual bottle I want to use and clean water. And everything is within reach. My pens, inks, my rubbing alcohol, and it's just nice to work in an environment like this. I know there is a tendency to use lots of paper when we are working, so I find that it's a good idea to have a kind of drawer cabinet like that, and I just keep like all kinds of stuff in there, like unused paper, work in progress, scrap paper. So it just keeps everything within reach. Otherwise, all my papers is going to be on the table. So a little, paper cabinet like this shouldn't be too expensive. It's about, I got this one for about $50 on Amazon. Okay, so now that we have a clean table, I'm going to talk about the basic materials that I use when I'm writing. So first of all is the pen holder. You can just buy one if you like, but you must always have at least 4 or 5 nibs, just in case it breaks or it falls down, or through wear and tear, you need to replace your nibs. They are not meant to be usable forever, and they are meant to be disposable. So don't feel like you gotta hang on to your nibs forever. So if it goes bad, just throw it out and put another one in. You could get different kinds of nibs and just, you know, keep using the same holder. But personally, I like to use different holders for different nibs. The reason is I don't like to keep, you know, pulling it out and crimping and everything. So I just have many different pen holders, and each of these pen holders hold a different kind of nib. So that way I don't have to keep, you know, messing around with the flange. But you don't have to do this. You can just buy one holder and use it for as long as you like. It's important to keep your nibs and pen holders clean, especially the flange. So I am not the best example of this because my flanges tend to be terrible. But the point is, I keep the nib clean. The reason why my flanges are dirty is because I never take them out, so the ink just accumulates on it. But if you can keep them clean, like this one is fairly clean. If you can keep it clean, then that's great. You just don't want it to become so dirty and crusted that you cannot remove the nib. Because if you keep dipping into ink, and let's say the ink seeps all the way into the flange and it dries there, and the nib will rust and it will stick to the flange. And when that happens, you know, sometimes it's really difficult to remove the nib. And it has happened to me before that I keep struggling with it, and this thing snaps and it breaks, and the top of the wood just broke. So that was a pretty bad time. Luckily, it was repairable. So to keep the nibs clean, I always have some paper towels on hand. So to keep the nibs clean, every few seconds or so, I just dip it in water and clean it and dry it with a paper towel. You don't want ink to dry on the nib ever, because the ink will form a coat on your nib and it's just gonna mess with your writing. So, if possible, never ever let ink dry on your holder or your nib. So, you know, make sure you always swirl it in some clean water and use the paper holder to remove and to dry, because you don't want water to dry on the nib either, because sometimes you just dip it and just leave it and the water will rust the nib. So paper towel is very handy to keep it clean and dry. You can use an oak cloth if you want, or a microfiber cloth or whatever, but personally I like a paper towel because, you know, once it gets dirty, I can just throw it away. So here is an old paper towel that I've used. So you can see I've used it to clean my nib like so many times. And I thought it was due to be thrown away because if you keep using it, like if you have a piece of cloth and you keep using it, and if you clean it on the same spot where there's ink, you know, you might pick up some of the ink. So once it's full of dirt like that, you can just throw it out and get a new fresh paper towel. This might be a little too pedantic or too crazy, but personally, I like Viva paper towels. It's because I find that the texture is smooth and it doesn't have a lot of fibers that stick out of it. Some cheaper paper towels, you know, I find that some of the fibers stick to the nib and it shows when you're writing, and it's very irritating. But Viva brand paper towels are smooth and it doesn't have the fibers sticking out. And I use it for other kinds of artwork as well. And if you think this is too crazy, you know, you can use anything you want. I like to keep my inks in a big enough container to admit an oblique holder. So you can dip it, you know, without hitting any sides of the corner. Some inks come in smaller bottles, like that. So you cannot dip in it, so you gotta remove the ink. Well, this one comes with an eyedropper, so it doesn't matter. But like bottles like that, sometimes the mouth is so small you cannot dip in properly. You gotta kind of like tip the ink, you know, and do this, and that's not always ideal because it might spill. Or you could try to force your way, you know, into the bottle, and that's also not ideal because now the sides of the bottle will hit the side of your holder, and once you hold it, it's gonna get, you know, on your fingers, and once it gets on your fingers, you know, it might get on your paper. So it's always important to keep your work environment clean. So the next time you go to Target or whatever, just get a tiny container to put your ink in. And you can find small containers like that anywhere. If you think a container like this is too big and you don't want to fill the whole thing with ink, you can always fill the bottom half with, you know, a solid object like a marble or stones or something, so that you only need to use a little bit of ink to fill up your bottle. You could also use an inkwell, but just make sure that the inkwell has a cover, or preferably an airtight cover. It's because that, you know, if you live in a dry area like I do, the ink will evaporate. So you can see, I'm not sure if you can see, but my ink has evaporated by almost half a centimeter because I left the top open overnight. So in order to minimize, you know, evaporated ink, it's a good idea to cover your ink bottles when you're not using them. As for water containers, you can use whatever you want, but it's a good idea to have a substantial amount. It's because, you know, if you're using a very messy ink like Sumin, you need a lot of water. You need a lot of water to clean it. And if you're using only a tiny amount of water, then you gotta keep, you know, it gets dirty really quick and you gotta keep going to the sink. So, you know, save yourself some trouble and just get a big container of water. You don't need these things, but I find they're really helpful. I always have some coffee stirrers on hand, and it's because some inks need stirring. For example, a bottle of bleedproof white, it's not a good idea to shake it because it will create air bubbles, and you know the ink will get everywhere and it'll crust. So what I do is I like to have a coffee stirrer to. Oh dear. See, I shouldn't have shaken it because it's already coming off. So a coffee stirrer is great for just stirring it like that. So you don't ever have to shake your bottles and create a mess like that. Another nice to have item is a chopstick holder, so you can rest your holder on it. It's not super necessary, but sometimes, you know, you might rest the holder upside down like that and it's full of ink and it, you know, it does that, right? So a chopstick holder is like 50 cents, so, and it'll last you forever. As as for paper, I like to have loose sheets of paper when I'm writing and not in a pad. The reason is because if I'm using a pad, you see the bottom, my wrist here would be rubbing against the bottom of the pad. It's very annoying, or you know, like that, my finger might catch on the sides or whatever, and it again obstructs from the flow of my arm. So I always just remove one sheet and use it like that. So when it's flat on the paper, on the table like that, nothing is obstructed. It's also very important to have some cushion sheets underneath the actual paper you're using. So these are just like scrap and old stuff that I work on. And you need to have at least 5 or 6 scrap sheets. And they could be anything. They could be like old papers or even newspapers or those marketing flyer sheets that you get in the mail. Just get a whole bunch and place the actual paper you want to use on top of it. This way, the surface of your paper is cushioned by your cushion sheets, and it feels a lot better than writing it on a hard table. It's a bit, I'm not sure how to explain it, but writing on a cushioned surface like this is much easier for the nib and ink to flow. I can't spell. Cushion. Now, if I was to write it on a hard piece of table without any cushion sheets, you know, it's different. And you know, the only way for you to find out is to try it, and maybe you'll know what I mean. So at least 5-6 pieces of cushion sheet. If you're using a guideline, you can put your guides underneath the paper you're using. And if your paper is thin enough, you should be able to see the guides through it. Another important thing that I need to have is a guard sheet. So this is again a piece of scrap paper that I put over the paper I'm using. This is so that my hands is on the guard sheet and nothing is touching the paper I want to use. The reason is because sometimes my hand has oils or dirt or grime or maybe ink, and I don't want that to transfer on the paper I'm using. For example, even oils from your fingers, if you rub it hard enough on paper, ink will be kind of funny on it because oil repels, you know, water and ink. So by guarding the paper you want to use with a guard sheet, you're making sure that nothing touches the actual paper you want to use. And it's even more important if this paper is like expensive or rare, or you know, or you can't find it easily. An additional advantage of using a guard sheet is that before you write, you can always use it as a test. For example, you know, you're not sure if the ink's going to flow well, so you can just test and then do the real thing. So there are three layers to writing: the guard sheet, the actual paper you're writing on, a guideline if you're using it, and 5 or 6 pieces of cushion sheet.